I am the newly appointed, so I'm still cutting my teeth a little, the newly appointed honorary chair of the Economic Club of Canada, and I'm delighted to be here today. Thank you. For those of you who don't know, the Economic Club is all about bringing together folks like all of you, the private sector, the public sector, and what we try and do is actually try to figure out how by convening this sort of ecosystem, we can actually help foster economic innovation with social impact that all contributes to Canada's economy. So I'm delighted that we can actually do that today in collaboration with Green Shield Canada and Room for Her. And we'll be talking today about looking forward, women's mental health and the future of work. You'll see some bags, I think, around your seats, hopefully. That was graciously provided by Green Shield, so thank you for that. In general, I like to do a little bit of digging on topics. I'm in financial services as part of my day job, and so when things like this come up, I'm like, I want to actually learn a little bit about what's happening. And you hear about it anecdotally, but then as I was kind of doing a little bit of digging, I came up with an interesting stat that I'll share with all of you, and many of you are already in the space, but I was like, whoa, that's a pretty kind of crazy number. Stats Canada report, so credible source. They conducted a study, and in 2021, for people employed, young women aged 25 to 54 had the highest prevalence of mental health-related disability, to the tune of 13%. And that was up significantly from 2019, up 4.7%. That number is also quite different for their male counterparts. These are pretty crazy numbers. And no doubt, and I kind of am done, I'm sure like many of you talking about the pandemic, but no doubt that that was actually further exacerbated through the pandemic with the multiple roles that women take on. And so with us constituting actually more than 50% of the Canadian population, mental health and well-being is key to building, healing, and growing the Canadian economy. This is why we're thrilled to actually help convene this ecosystem together today with Green Shield and Room for Her. So, to start things off with us today, I would like to introduce all of you to somebody who is currently, come on up, Zahid, the CEO and president of the not-for-profit providing fully integrated health services. And he does this both on the payer and the provider side. For those of you who don't know what that means, provider meaning he does benefits administration, he himself actually. offering insurance and paying claims, but also on the provider side where they actually provide medical, mental, and pharmacy services, all contributing to, quite frankly, all of our better health and well-being. And so, without much further ado, he's significantly credentialed. He is the CEO. He's had extensive management experience and board experience. The CEO of Green Shield Canada, Zahid Salman.
Morning, everyone. So we do have more than one person who works at Green Shield. We've got a number of our colleagues in the room today. It's great to see everyone in person. I think we've got about 200 or so people who had signed up to attend in person, another 500 or so who signed up to attend online. So that's just wonderful, the interest on such an important topic. Last year, when we did our first Room for Her event, we were alone in a studio by ourselves trying to create energy and excitement. Whereas here, we've actually got people who are going to help us with that energy and excitement today. Kashmira said it well. I mean, we spent a lot of time talking about the pandemic. I'm going to have to start there as well. Even though the pandemic is now subsiding and restrictions are starting to lift and we'll be able to get together from time to time with larger groups, there's two inalienable facts about the pandemic. One is the pandemic has driven a significant need for extra support around mental health services. If you look at just what we see from our vantage points as an insurance company, mental health claims have increased by more than 70% since prior to the pandemic. We now have one in five Canadians who reported seeking out mental health care during the pandemic. And that's just the tip of the iceberg because many people still don't access care because of the stigma, and many people just don't have access to the care at all. But still, so many are trying to reach out and trying to get help for their mental health. So that's one fact that's come out of the pandemic. The other one is that the pandemic has had a disproportionate impact on women. One of the statistics that's really resonated with me and impacted me about the size of the issue is that 100,000 women left the workforce in Canada during the pandemic because the responsibility for things like childcare, elder care, fell disproportionately on them. And if we want to really emerge from the pandemic, these two issues, the need for extra resources around mental health and recognizing the disproportionate impact the pandemic has had on women and their ability to remain in the workplace and thrive in the workplace, is something that we collectively need to solve for. And within that, you think about racialized women and how they have struggled even more when you think about their ability to access services. We work with a number of community foundations who target mental health services at racialized populations, underserved populations, and what they tell us is it's a real challenge to access some of these care. So what we've tried to do with Room for Her was really help start to create a conversation and some solutions around these two issues that I mentioned earlier. So let me tell you a bit more about Green Shield in terms of why we've chosen to focus on this area and why and how we're trying to help solve it. So first of all, the origin story of Green Shield is over 65 years old now. It all began when our founder, who was a pharmacist named William Wilkinson, based in Windsor, he had a young mother come into a store and she had two prescriptions to fill, but she could only afford one. So she chose to fill the prescription for her daughter and she forewent the prescription she needed for herself. So this issue of affordable access to prescription drugs really impacted Bill. And he founded Green Shield by first creating Canada's first prepaid drug plan, which is something many of us who are employed enjoy today. And he started Green Shield Canada, which was based on the social mission of providing access or ensuring access to care for Canadians. And that's guided us for the next 65 years. We've grown now. We're Canada's fourth largest health insurer. We serve over 5 million Canadians, but we're driven by that social mission. And because of that, we're still structured to this very day as a not-for-profit social enterprise. So all the earnings that we gain from our business activities, we put back into the communities with a focus on mental health and oral health. In fact, our plan is to contribute $75 million to mental health and oral health-related causes through 2025. So as we thought about how to go about doing that, there's two ways. One is we use our funding to support causes in the community. We fund many community foundations because they're closest to the needs in the various communities where we live and work. The second one was because of the services that we have, as was mentioned, we're not just an insurance company, but we're also a service provider on health services. We thought, well, how can we take our services and deploy them to benefit the communities, and in particular, the underserved populations? So what we decided to do was to fund this Room for Her program, which is a free service available to all Canadian women because of the disproportionate impact that they've experienced during the pandemic. And we launched it last year with 10,000 free counseling hours delivered by our mental health arm, Inkblot. And then we've expanded it since then by adding more counseling hours. But then also, we recently introduced online internet cognitive behavioral therapy, which is a one-year subscription for women to use and to really build resiliency and take a self-guided approach to helping improve their own mental health. So a multi-million dollar investment, and I'm really happy to say that less than a year in, we've already helped 26,000 Canadian women with their mental health. So lots more to do, and we're obviously only one organization. There's only so much we can do. So having events like this where we bring together experts and other important stakeholders in the field is what we think is going to be so important to really elevating this issue and bringing us all together in an ecosystem to deliver the care that we need to emerge from the pandemic, not just well, but also healthy, and allow women to thrive both personally and professionally. So now I want to take a moment to introduce the next speaker. It's my great privilege to introduce the Honorable Charmaine Williams, the Associate Minister of Women's Social and Economic Opportunity. Charmaine was elected to the Legislative Assembly of Ontario in the 2022 provincial election. She represents the riding of Brampton Centre. My wife is actually a principal in Brampton. As a member of the Progressive Conservative Party of Ontario, she's currently the Associate Minister of Women's Social and Economic Opportunity and is the first black woman to be appointed to a PC cabinet. Prior to provincial politics, Charmaine was elected to the Brampton City Council. Minister Williams has also had a 19-year career as a certified multi-systemic therapist, behavioral consultant, and counselor. As a mother of five children, she understands the importance of advocating for those who cannot always advocate for themselves. As a Brampton City Councillor, she had the opportunity to spearhead numerous economic, social, and cultural initiatives that benefited Brampton communities. Her track record of success is a testament to her ability to help communities thrive, build programs and institutions to support vulnerable populations, and provide dependable leadership. She now carries her passion and experience into her new role as the Associate Minister of Women, Social, and Economic Opportunity, where she intends to make a lasting effort and positively impact women and families across Ontario. So we're thrilled to have Charmaine here with us. Please come to the stage.
Hi, is it morning? Good morning? Good afternoon? Yeah, it's still morning. I'm just really impressed that Zahid was able to do all of that without looking at a single page. That was impressive. I'm going to be looking at pages because I have a tendency to go all over the place. But it is such a delight to be here with you all today to engage in a discussion about women's mental health and the future of work. And I know we've talked about the pandemic, but as a person with a background in mental health, we know that women were disproportionately impacted by it. But what is also a reality is that the ripple effects of the trauma, because it was traumatic for many people, of COVID, we're gonna feel those effects for the next few years. So we have to address mental health and find new and creative ways to make sure women in their homes get access to the resources that are available. We also know that women are overrepresented in jobs that pay minimum wage and part-time employment, but underrepresented in many of the fastest growing and highest paying sectors, such as STEM fields of science, technology, engineering, and math, as well as the skilled trades. A couple weeks ago, I had the opportunity to go to Thunder Bay. Has anybody been out there before? Anybody from Thunder Bay? Oh, there's a lot. That's amazing. It's beautiful out there. I didn't get to see the sleeping giant, though, because it was very overcasted. I met with the Carpenters Union while in Thunder Bay, and our discussion was centered around how they are working to bring more women into the trades. And it is also something our government is very committed to do. They are expecting an 11% labor shortage in the next 5 years due to retirement. That's significant. That's around 140,000 people. This is a valuable industry. The skilled trades alone, there's extreme opportunities. And I see that women can be a key part in filling that gap. That said, we also know that women who are low income experience significant barriers to access skills training. Barriers include a lack of financial resources to replace earnings while in training, as well as access to affordable childcare, mental health, and legal and housing supports. I think it's clear that the status quo for women in our economy is not an option. And we have a great opportunity in the next few years to push the reset button and bring women into the heart of the post-pandemic economy. This is also why, when we think about some of the barriers, we have to think about safety. Our government is committed to preventing and addressing violence against women, because what we know that regardless of your economic status, violence against women, femicide, is a reality. We are also looking to address human trafficking and providing wraparound supports to help women who have been victim of these crimes to heal and rebuild their lives. Last year alone, we invested nearly $200 million in services and supports for women, for victims of violence, and $11 million for women in violence prevention services. Keeping women safe is a part of a holistic approach. A holistic approach to supporting the well-being and participation of women in the workforce. And a holistic approach includes providing access to childcare, which is why we were able to sign a historic agreement of $13.5 billion with the federal government. also, we know there's a housing shortage. And I've been really amazed with the organizations that are out there doing great things with little. An organization like Arma House in Mississauga. It is the only second stage housing support system for women in Peel. And they are so successful that they're seeing women with this holistic wraparound supports leaving their homes and moving into housing in as little as 6 months. It is an area that I am committed to making sure that we as a government are seeing more houses and programs like Arma House go up around Ontario. We also know that housing, when you don't have access to housing, you end up recycling back into our system. And our short-term sheltering system is reaching capacities. And at some points, we're hearing stories of women who have kids, because we have children, and we're leaving with three or four kids. And that means there's less space in these houses for women to be able to place their children and take up the beds that would be for other women. So we are working really hard with across ministries, especially the municipal affairs, and looking at ways to make sure that women have housing. We also have our roadmap to wellness, which is a provincial strategy that takes a whole of government approach to address long-standing mental health and addiction needs, with a historic investment of $3.8 billion over the next 10 years. It requires investing in women's mental health through this roadmap to wellness, because we know, especially in this government, we have to address it. The only government to actually create an associate ministry of addictions and mental health. And we've been able to do that because, like I said, the next few years, with the impacts of the pandemic, we're going to see higher cases of addictions and mental health coming through. So it is a commitment. I'm also really excited because just on Tuesday, I was able to do my first announcement as a minister. and it was a call for proposals and a call for applications to our Investing in Women's Futures program. One of some of the driving factors we see to women, experiencing a lot of challenges and recycling back into our system is precarious, low-paying jobs and childcare. Well, this program, we're investing $6.9 million to see the 25 homes that we, or programs that are receiving the funding, to have extended funding, but also 10 more sites that provide holistic and skills enhancement programs to women only, getting opened up across Ontario. So if you're an organization that does that, check it out on ontario.ca. It really has a proven track record with almost more than 5,000 women across the province last year, across the province, getting support, and 1,300 women secure employment, start their own business, or pursue further education and training. So I'm really excited about that. I didn't go on my notes on that, so I'm going to go back here. So as we look to the future and look ahead to the future of women for work in Ontario, we have to put strong foundation on holistic approach. A foundation that builds on the work of partners across sectors in education, business, healthcare, and community services. But I know we can't start there. And as I delve into my ministry, I see the importance of continuing to support women's well-being. We recognize how a woman's traditional support system has changed, and family members and community supports have turned to a more institutional look. Do any of you guys remember the Welcome Wagon? Yes. Right? They came to my house when my son was first born 18 years ago. This is how communities used to operate. You used to have the local church or welcome wagon. These were the programs and things that were just so grassroots that would help people connect to neighbors. You'd know Nancy down the street would be able to take the kids after school. Or, so-and-so is able to give the kids a ride. I just find that we've become a little bit more fragmented. We don't have that connection anymore, and we need to get back to that connection. I love the welcome wagon. I'd love to see it start up again. You know, today's a really, today's an interesting day for me. 5 years ago today, I woke up with a massive headache. A headache that wouldn't stop. It was a headache that brought me to the hospital, where I learned that I was suffering from a massive brain hemorrhage. That day was just 6 days after I had my fifth baby, Malcolm. So I've got five kids, and I'm in the hospital being told that you're having a brain hemorrhage, and this was in between consciousness, and that I might have to go to Trillium Hospital to have the pressure relieved. That was a life-changing experience, naturally. And it taught me and it reminded me that life is really short. And as women, we put a lot of pressure on ourselves to do everything, but also we do a lot of holding ourselves back. And I don't want any of you here to have a massive health scare like a brain hemorrhage that I had to realize that. There's so much power and strength in this space that I can see. And I know we want to do so much of it in our day-to-day lives, take care of the kids. But let me tell you something. It is okay to go to Metro and pick up cookies for the bake sale and say you made them. Okay? One of the other pieces that came out of the economic task force for women in the economy was the need for mentors. That was a task force that was done last term, and it was eye-opening for many people because one of the main things that women were asking for are mentors. And when you are in a position to be able to provide guidance and support to women, please do it. Please open your experience, your heart, that place from within where you know what it's like to have to run at 6 a.m. to go to Metro to get the cookies, right? And to say to another woman that it's okay. And I think every dollar that a company spends, that we spend to do these things, we get back tenfold in the workforce. We get it back. Because when women know that they have the flexibility to be able to take care of something, they'll be able to say, all right, I'm gonna be able to commit A, B, and C of my time for the job. So we gotta take care of our women because women are the heart and the center of families, communities, and Ontario. And when women succeed, Ontario succeeds. So I just wanna thank you all for being here today and thank you to Green Shield and this amazing panel and all the women that are gonna be here talking and sharing their experiences. And I wish I could stay, unfortunately, as a government official. I've got a lot of places to go to. But thank you so much. And I don't know where I am in my notes anymore, so I'm going to end there. Have a great conference.
Five kids later, a real call to action, health, well, life and death scare. I think the takeaway from all of that is life is fragile. And all of us here, I started this by saying we're an ecosystem that have to prop each other up. I'm looking at you, Rhiannon, because Minister, she talked about mentorship and advocacy, and I gotta give a shout out to Rhiannon because I'm actually in the position of honorary chair because and I know I'm new to it, but Rhiannon actually is the one that advocated for me to take this on. So I hear you loud and clear. Find your advocates, find your mentors, and help kind of lift each other up to kind of get to where you want to be. And you may not even know you want to go there yet, which is kind of neat. So thank you so much. We're actually off to our next panel, and so I have the privilege of introducing them. The panel now is on female entrepreneurs breaking down barriers and mental health. And so we're going to call to the stage our moderator, Komal, who is from, and I hope I'm saying it right, Karseva? Yes. And alongside her, we have all of our panelists. We'll start with Rachel Toledano. I'm going to try and make some room. Who is PhD, clinical psychologist. There's a lot of credentials with all the women on this panel. It's kind of nuts. Vice President, Clinical Services at Inkblot. Wendy Sukier, MBA, MA, PhD, founder and academic director of the Diversity Institute, academic director of Women Entrepreneurship Hub, and the research lead of Future Skills Center. I just referenced Rhiannon. Rhiannon Rosland, creator and CEO of Conscious Economics and Lunar Studios. And Silken Lahman, former Olympian and founder of Unsinkable Youth. So over to you, ladies.
Thank you so much. Checking this mic. This mic is now hot. There we go. Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. I have a few questions before I bring the questions to the panel. And the first is, how many founders are in the room or want to be founders? Please raise your hands. Oh, I love to see it. How many folks who are managers or executives or leaders in the corporate or nonprofit space? Hands up. Amazing. Thank you all for sharing. This is just going to help me guide our questions for the afternoon. We have both founders and high impact leaders here that we are speaking to. And something that was mentioned in the opening remarks that we know is abundantly true is that the pandemic disproportionately hit women, our mental health, our well-being in massive ways. Mothers in particular, women of color in particular as well. So Wendy, there's a lot of research that the Women's Entrepreneurship Knowledge Hub has done in regards to this in the last few years. Are you able to share a little bit of the findings around this impact and also the ways that women have shown up resiliently in response to the challenges that we faced as business owners and leaders?
Yeah, well, as was mentioned, all women were disproportionately affected by the pandemic. The impact was heaviest on older women and younger women, strangely, perhaps. And as was also mentioned, we know that Indigenous peoples, racialized peoples, persons with disabilities, and so on, were also affected more than others. I think one of the things that our research has shown is that entrepreneurs, in general, are under more pressure and are often more isolated in their day-to-day work, and the pandemic really exacerbated that. So you take all those factors together and look at women entrepreneurs, look at racialized women entrepreneurs, and the impacts were just devastating. What we found, we did a project with the Bank of Montreal and looked at the results for 1,000 women entrepreneurs. And what we found was they were not only suffering because they were their businesses were in jeopardy and they had higher rates of closing their doors and dislocation and so on, but the impact of having to lay off staff, for example, was devastating for many of them. And then you add to that, and I remember very clearly one of the respondents said, I feel like I'm not doing anything well. You know, my business is tanking, I'm having to lay off my staff, I'm not providing the support that my kid needs because I'm trying to save my business, I'm a complete failure. And I think the point the minister made about women putting too much pressure on themselves, in addition to all of the societal burdens of unpaid work and so on, plus the barriers we know women face, really put a lot of women entrepreneurs on very precarious ground. And I have to mention, because this was brought up as well, when we compared members of the Canadian Federation of Independent Business with members of the Black Business Professional Association, we found that in general, small business owners were suffering. Half of the members of the Canadian Federation for Independent Business, for example, said they couldn't take on more debt. 98% of the members of the Black Business Professional Association said they could not take on more debt. And what we found is on every single metric, the negative impacts of COVID and the lack of access to supports were twice as high for Black entrepreneurs generally. And so the point that was made earlier about intersectionality, I think, is key. If we looked at Indigenous entrepreneurs, and particularly Indigenous women entrepreneurs, we know that half of Indigenous peoples live on reserve, often in the north. Think about the pivots to online services, both in terms of distribution for companies, but also access to government services, to financing, and so on. And half the population doesn't have access to internet. I mean, they don't have access to running water, so high-speed internet is sort of out of the question. But the issues around digitization and internet access also affected people in downtown Toronto. 42% of racialized families could not afford access to internet and had kids doing their homework on smartphones. So all of the factors, I think, that we know have created disparity in society were amplified during COVID, and women entrepreneurs, particularly those who are racialized or Indigenous, really suffered. And we see that in the data in terms of mental health.
Thank you for sharing that, and I look forward to hearing from the next panel of those lived experiences firsthand as well. And something that you mentioned was that there was an individual who had said, you know, I feel like I'm failing at all of it. I'm not doing well at all of it. Who here felt that way at any point in the last few years? Who felt like that this week? Yeah, me too. So when we think about this, we are the statistics, we are the stats, we are the people who are being researched, studied, looked at, and examined to see that this data can be used now moving forward in policy, in the ways that we are moving forward, the agenda to proactively move our stories and our journeys forward. So I bring that back to us, to our lived experiences, because while we hear it as data, it's actually what we've gone through and what we've lived through. And one of my friends, who's an incredible poet, Rupi Kaur, she has a poem that says, "The irony of loneliness is that we feel it all at the same time." And so I think that's true with a lot of these challenges that we're gonna be discussing today. So Silken, you are an elite athlete, an Olympian. You recovered from a major injury to perform at the Olympics in a matter of, like, you had shattered a part of your body and recovered so quickly that you were able to then actually compete. And I can only imagine the pressure that elite athletes have on them. Entrepreneurs have similar pressures. But when we look at transitioning out of our careers, or for a lot of women founders, they had to pivot their businesses. What are some of the things that helped you transition, that helped you feel strong in moving from your career as a professional athlete into your career as a founder, and that strange in-between? I think that a lot of us experience transition regularly and could use some expert advice.
First of all, I'm no longer an Olympian. I'm a mom, I've got 4 kids. I founded Unsinkable Youth. I'm a social entrepreneur, and I'm married to an entrepreneur as well. So I really know the reality that all of you have been living in, either from the social impact side, seeing how much the need is increasing, and the frustration sometimes that we feel that we just can't help people fast enough, particularly in this mental health space. My husband owns Good Life Fitness. And you can imagine how well the fitness business did over the last 3 years, you know. So he is not a small business, he's a big business, but 70% of fitness clubs in this country closed their doors, right? So we've been living and breathing all of this, and it's been an incredibly difficult time. You know, as a high performance athlete, things are very black and white. You know, you go out, you are super focused on one thing. Your whole life is directed towards these goals of winning, and you know, and then you get out into the what we call the real world in sport. I was pregnant 6 weeks after I finished my athletic career because my sister had taken 9 years to get pregnant. So I thought I'd better get started, and then 6 weeks later, I was pregnant, and it was a huge, huge transition for me in my life, and one of the things I really had to learn, and I think I'm still learning, is the standard of perfect does not apply to real life. It just doesn't. If you want to be healthy and happy, you need to let go of that incredibly destructive word, right? Perfect. Good enough has to be good enough. And it took me a long time. And in fact, for me, it was 5 years after competing. I had a 2 and a 4-year-old, and I went to Phoenix, Arizona to have a working holiday. Any of you try to have a working holiday with your kids? There's not enough laughter on that, because this this really, you know, we went down the water slides. You know, I rented a hotel room where it could accommodate the kids' needs. I came into the hotel room that evening thinking I was going to get some work done while the kids watched TV. And, of course, they immediately started whining that they want to go down the water slide again, and that, the, you know, their bathing suit had a thread that was bothering them. And suddenly I just had what I will say was a meltdown. And I thought for a moment that I was going to hurt my kids. And I grabbed my phone, I locked my hotel room with my kids in it, and I called for help. And that was the first moment I realized I couldn't do it alone. I couldn't be a parent. I couldn't buy the cookies or bake the cookies for the bake sale. I couldn't, you know, be a speaker and an entrepreneur and somebody who was also involved in community. I couldn't do it all at once. And it was through getting help for my mental health, which I didn't even have a word. I didn't know those words, mental health. I thought something was really wrong with me, essentially, as like a human being. And there began the education process of how to live well, and how to be a mother and somebody who cares about community, and you know, to do all these things, but to do it differently. And I really related to the minister's comments this morning about women being the center of everything else. I really like, we are the center of our family still. And when mama's not doing well, nobody's doing well. And one of the things that I really had to learn in this perfectionistic, driven, hyper-competitive world that I not only came from, but is in my DNA. You know, my kids tell me that I'm the most pathologically competitive person that they've ever met. You know, so, you know, that's within me. But I couldn't be that as a mom anymore. And so I had to learn things like when enough is enough, how to use that magical two-letter word, no. I was mentored by other women. One woman said to me, ask yourself this question. When you say yes, what are you saying no to? So every Saturday morning that I committed to throwing out the opening pitch in a ball game or coming to speak to schools, I might come still speak to your child's school, but it was a conscious decision to say no to time with my kids. And being more conscious and more powerful in myself, my boundaries, my decisions, that was probably one of the biggest lessons that I had to learn in life after sport.
Thank you so much, Silken, for that beautiful response. I think when you see a banner like the Economic Club of Canada, you might not expect the depth of vulnerability that we're absolutely hearing today, both from the minister and on this panel. And Gloria Steinem, when she wrote her book On the Road, she would describe these moments she would take on the road and call them sharing circles at colleges and universities. And so I just want us to contain this space together of this is a safe space for these conversations to happen, for our experiences of this last few years to come to a head in one way or another. GSC and Inkblot are bringing us here to talk mental health, so we're really going there. And so I just want to honor that vulnerability and the emotions, the experiences that we're all having in this room together. And with that in mind, something that I'm sure none of us have been immune to, regardless of our identity, is something called imposter syndrome. And as Cash mentioned, with taking on the Economic Club recently, and we're going to chat with Rhiannon a little bit about this transition of leadership, but before we get there, a quote around imposter syndrome, Rachel, we're going to chat about this now, that always stuck with me is Mindy Kaling said in interviews, like, people would always ask her. She's such a highly productive human. So many shows coming out. She did the Mindy Project for a number of years. And people ask her, do you have imposter syndrome? She's like, would you ask this to a man? If I had to produce 22 shows and write on 22 shows a year or season for The Office, I would have to be pathologically unconfident to do what I do now and to try and live this without imposter syndrome. But that's Mindy Kaling. But for the rest of us who have experienced this, who do experience it, Rachel, what advice would you have for those of us who are entering new spaces, who are in transitions, or who are getting promoted or raises or raising funds for their company and feeling that unbeatable imposter syndrome at moments? How can they amplify themselves, level up, feel the confidence that they're looking for?
That's a great question. Thank you for bringing it up. I think that we're all exposed to our conditioning, right? Our social conditioning, our cultural, religious conditioning. There's a context that brings us to a point where even in the face of success, all we see is a fear of failure. And that brings back the idea of perfectionism, right? Which is one of our main social values, is perfectionism. And that chips away slowly but surely at our self-confidence, at our self-esteem, our self-worth. I think that it's important to mention that, you know, there is a tendency for women to be in self-doubt, but it's not because they aren't confident, it's because they have been conditioned to question whether they're good enough. Right? So even when you are promoted to a position of VP, of CEO, of president, even if you're a founder and you're successful and you're raising funds and you're actually seeing success, there's always a conditioned response of, but is it good enough? And I guess if I were to address the audience and address the women, not just that are in this room, but all the Canadian women that are watching, I hope, is who is going to decide if it's good enough for you, right? Who's going to write your story? So everybody has a story that they heard, and that's the conditioning. And where is that coming from? And what's the interests behind those stories? But the real power of women comes from deciding that we're going to write our own story. Nobody will tell us what we're capable of, what's good enough. So, you know, recognize your accomplishments, the small ones, the big ones. Allow yourselves to know that everything comes in waves. So there's episodes where you feel weak, where you feel tired, where you feel burnt out, where you feel self-doubt. But it doesn't have to be your story, right? You can fight that. And that's where we actually have power. So hopefully, you know, if we look at what we've accomplished in terms of women progressing, you know, in the workplace or otherwise, we've made a lot of progress. But we still have a lot to go. And so we're not going to wait 150 years for the gender gap to be closed. We're going to do what we can today and control what we can today. I would say that if, you know, I talk to a lot of people in the last 20 years that I've been a therapist. I've heard a lot of stories, imposter syndrome, and am I going to make it? I always say that human beings create what they're afraid of. You know, if you're afraid to fail, it affects your next move, your next choice. And that leads to failure very often. Because you could have made it all the way up. But because you were afraid that you can't, then that fear kind of, that's the vicious cycle, right? So don't let anybody tell you what you can and cannot accomplish. I was raised by a very strong woman. My grandmother, I always say she must have been royalty somewhere because she was regal when you looked at her. And she had 5 daughters. And every single one of them is so strong and independent. Those were my mentors, right? My models, my role models. Each and every one of us needs to look up to a role model. And there are so many strong, successful, intelligent, creative women that we can look up to. So for me, it was my mom, who became a lawyer at 42. We went to university at the same time. She was a legal secretary, and one day she decided, I'm sick of doing the work for the lawyers, and they're getting paid for it. I'm going to become a lawyer. So we started university at the same time, and when I got my master's degree, she finished the bar. So we actually went through graduation at the same time, which was awesome. And to me, that's what I want to show my daughter. That's what I want to show my team. Even my team is right now a team of women. We're looking for men, but right now we're a strong team of women, and I want to push them up. And the more, like, really even choosing who we surround ourselves with. If somebody's pulling you down, you can decide to get them out of your circle and surround yourselves with women who want you to succeed and who are there for you, a community of women, you know? And there are many. There are many. I like the idea of community. I like the idea of, you know, if you can compliment a woman and congratulate a woman and tell her she's doing awesome and she looks great, it's free. Mm-hmm. But the impact is huge. So, you know, the imposter syndrome it's inside our heads. And it's something we can fight because it's inside our heads. And that's what I think Room for Her aims to do, is give women access to the tools to fight those things, because the question is always, oh, yes, yes, I hear you, I feel you, Rachel, but how? Well, the how is, you know, that's what we want to offer women across Canada, right? We want to offer you the keys, but the solution is within you, and don't let anybody tell you otherwise. I've seen it every day, right?
Thank you so much, Rachel.
Thank you.
I have dived into resiliency research this last many years, and there's a gap in resiliency research that's starting to be filled around the impacts or how Black, Indigenous, and people of color become more resilient. Why are so many of us so resilient? One of the key factors that I saw in one report was our connection to our culture, heritage, language, and community. And so when you say that about, you think of your ancestors, you think of your mother, you think of the people, the women, the royalty in your lineage of how we perceive our elders. I feel the same way. And I feel that strength come when I'm feeling doubt. I'm like, well, what would my grandmother say to me right now? So we can borrow that confidence from those who came before us. And I love that as a tool to counter that imposter syndrome. And now, Rhiannon, when you think of this following your intuition, coming home to yourself in your decision making, you recently sold the Economic Club of Canada and transitioned out of a role that you had for 14 years as a founder. And you are continuing your founder journey in this next chapter. And am I mistaken to say that this is your first time taking the stage after this transition?
Yeah.
And how has this transition been for you and making this choice for your well-being and your own future? And what advice would you have to founders who are making these sorts of hard choices mm-hmm. to kind of choose themselves and their well-being?
Thank you so much for the question, and thank you to all of you for being here today. As I look around the room, not only on the panel, but also out here, I see so many amazing people that I recognize and know and are doing incredible things in this country. The Economic Club of Canada is no easy organization to run, and so kudos to those that are running it now. It's a really high-pressured situation, as many of us face in our careers. We've talked about it, you know, Olympic athlete. For me, in running the Economic Club,
Rhiannon, I'm just going to pause. Maybe if you can grab Silken's mic, I just want to make sure you are heard.
In running the Economic Club of Canada, before the pandemic, we were doing approximately 100 events a year across the country. So that's multiple events a week. And a lot of the times, as many of you know who have attended events in the past, these are high-level corporate events, you know, C-level executives, heads of state, Secret Service, I mean, all the things. And we were a team of women that was running that organization behind the curtain when I took it over. Again, I wasn't the founder of the Economic Club. The Economic Club was started by another gentleman many years ago, and I was hired as an entry-level event coordinator straight out of TMU, which is Ryerson. My first event was hosting Bill Clinton in a room full of 1,500 of the most powerful executives in Canada. Fast forward, and we'll skip over a bunch of the story, but I became the CEO at 26 years old. It was a blind pass-off. Our founder and CEO was elected to federal parliament. I had stepped in to run the organization while he was in election mode, and all of a sudden, he was elected. I was told he wasn't going to be. And all of a sudden, I was taking over a very, very high-powered organization. So imposter syndrome, I mean, oh my gosh. I literally disguised myself. I mean, you can look back, and in the early days, I was wearing glasses that I didn't need, and I was trying to make myself look old. I really knew that I was very good at my job and I understood how to deliver on that side, but it was filling the shoes and the role when there hadn't been somebody that looked like me in my age bracket in that role before that was very challenging. And I want to open up about how challenging it really was, and I'm going to do that for the first time in this kind of setting, which feels a little bit more like lights are brighter and more corporate, but we're talking about it today, and I thank Green Shield so much for this initiative and for opening up this dialogue in these forums, because it's so important for us, not only as women, but all of us, all genders and identities, to talk about the struggle of mental health and the unbelievable infrastructure that has to be changed in the way that we approach business and our economy and policy in order to adjust. So I'm a mother of two as well. I had my first son 2 weeks after taking over the role of the Economic Club as CEO. So blind pass off, election, I'm pregnant. You know, I take it over and all of a sudden I have my first child. Never imagined what that was going to do to me either. Motherhood felt extremely isolating to me in the beginning. It was like my body wasn't able to keep up with the speed of what I was trying to accomplish. And I continued to hold the pressure on my shoulders of, I can do it all, I can fix it all, I can find a solution to every issue, I can still be a good wife, I can still be a good mother, I can be a good daughter, I can be a friend, I can do it all at once. And really for me, and I'm gonna just back up a little bit, and this is very important, we all have conditioning, like Rachel mentioned, we all have things that are in our sort of, you know, childhood and upbringing and things that we've witnessed. I grew up in a low-income household where my mother was violently abused my whole life, and there was a lot of addiction issues and other things in my household. Because I was at the position of being at the head of the Economic Club, the first person in my family to be, you know, a university graduate and all of these things, I felt that I had broken a cycle and I had made it by being in this very prestigious role, by being a homeowner, by being the mom and doing all of the things. But I had failed to recognize the power of my upbringing and how it was influencing my every single decision in terms of how I would people please, in terms of how I would pretend, in how I would just feel so unworthy in a room like this to represent a brand like this. And so I started to do a lot of work in community, and many of you know that, and you've been a part of some of that. But that also has its own toll, and if you're not taking care of yourself, you will burn out. And so I had my big burnout moment, and I cried when you were telling your story because I could feel it. 2017, middle of the Arctic Ocean, running a reconciliation program with youth, and something just snapped in me. It just snapped, and it was hearing everyone else's stories of trauma and realizing I hadn't addressed my own, and I was covering it up with success, awards, accolades, perfection, all of the things, and also alcohol. And I want to talk about alcohol. This is not your granddad's alcoholism, but women are struggling with their nervous system to turn themselves off after really busy weeks, after high pressure. And so we're using other things, other tools in order to just put your mind off. And that was something that I was doing as well. And although it wasn't the same as what I grew up in my household, it was impacting me. You don't sleep the same. Even with one glass of wine, you don't go into the same REM sleep. So I would work all week, and then the weekend would come, and this was my cycle. So I would actually start on Monday more tired than before, you know, and this is very, very socially conditioned in all of us that this is our way to relax, to connect, to have fun. So my choice in not only eventually selling the Economic Club, which I know is a big one, but starting Conscious Economics, where we could start to open up these dialogues and conversation around consciousness, well-being, and how that parlays into business. And also for me to, you know, take alcohol out of my life. It's been 5 years, and for me, again, it wasn't the same as what I saw growing up, so I didn't associate it as the same kind of issue, but it underlies a lot of our lives in terms of how we're dealing with stress and not understanding how to manage our nervous system. And I just want to shout out as well to my incredible friend Sandy's here, who's the manager of Serena Ryder, who's just this incredible powerhouse woman who've started Art House. And Serena is on this tour right now across Canada with her Art of Falling Apart album, talking about these same things. And so it's showing up now. It's in our collective consciousness. Green Shield is so right on the moment of what we need to discuss as an economy, as a collective, as women, as individuals. It's time for us to tell our stories openly. It's time for us to know there's another way. And I really believe that us women are on the precipice of creating that change. We can do it differently, and I know that we can. So thank you so much. Yeah.
A bit of an energetic purge when we're going to be going through these events, our first come back to IRL in person, especially when we're able to engage in this way, because there's just no space to not be honest and truthful anymore. This is our lived reality, and especially as our generation, for millennials, for those before us and those coming after, this sort of truth kind of dispels all of the rose-colored glasses of corporate, of coming into entrepreneurship. My generation was really force-fed entrepreneurship as the way. But what we don't talk about is that so many women defer to entrepreneurship because the systems and the businesses and the corporations we function in don't work for us. Yeah. They were not built for us. We are dispensable. We will be used and exited. There are so many clients that I work with who are high-level leaders who still have stacked up vacation time that they now have to use to recover from their burnout. Yeah. And that's not a vacation. That's not healthy. That's not how we need to operate. And Wendy, what I'm curious about in the research that you're seeing, when we're looking at the practical ways that leaders in this room, that the men in this room who are leaders, because the thing is, sometimes these conversations happen in an echo chamber. We as women know what our experience is, but how do we really galvanize the folks who are the women leaders who are changing policy, are the folks who are ministers and in public office who are changing policy, and then the male leaders in these industries and spaces who really can change the way that these organizations function. So what are some pieces of advice or things that you would suggest as beginning points to move the dial?
Ooh, big question. I think the first thing is naming the problem, and that's why I really appreciate the authentic, honest sharing that we're seeing in a very large room. Normally,
This is what I talk about with my therapist.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. This is so, and it's not just with respect to the challenges women face. But if you think about the fact that in Canada, we're finally willing to recognize genocide. We're finally willing to recognize anti-black racism. Like, I still remember, speaking of Olympians, when Donovan Bailey said racism was a problem in Canada, and he was vilified because Canadians had such a nice story about being so much better than the United States, et cetera, et cetera. And he said recently, racism is a problem in Canada, it's just politer. So I think naming these problems, and you know, we have the data that shows it's clear. People here have the experiences that and should understand that it's not just you, it is the system. There are very genuine challenges that, for example, women in business or women entrepreneurs face that are very different from the challenges men face. And you know, the data point I always come back to is in Toronto, half the population's racialized, half the population's white. Half the population is men, half the population is women or non-binary people. And yet when you look at corporate boards, white women outnumber racialized women 12-1. Mm-hmm. So we can't ignore intersectionality. We can't ignore the fact that white women still face barriers, but racialized women and our sisters in Indigenous communities and so on face more barriers. So naming the problem and really facing it, I think, is essential. I think the second thing is taking ownership. So there are lots of, you know, rainbow posters and Black North commitments, and you know, we're doing work on the 50-30 challenge to try to advance gender parity and increase diversity. There are lots of organizations that are stepping up and saying, yes, we want to make things better. But often there are real gaps between the aspirations and the reality. And, you know, the thing I keep saying is put your money where your mouth is, right? So if you're a large corporation, you say, we embrace EDI. Who are you buying product from? You know, we just did EDI strategy for Starbucks Canada, and one of the big issues is what's on the shelf and who makes what's on the shelf. So using the power, and that's, I'm actually a big fan of Green Shields because, you know, they may not have as high profile as some other corporations that shall not go nameless in terms of advancing mental health. But the work that they're doing is having genuine impact. Like, they don't put all their money into the advertising about what they're doing. They put their money into providing the services. And for me, that's really, 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 really fundamental. If we're looking specifically at trying to support women, we have to challenge the stereotypes. Like, do a Google search on entrepreneur, and what you'll get is white men, mostly in tech, etc. We have to be prepared to recognize Celine Dion is one of Canada's greatest entrepreneurs. Like, she's worth $600 million. And we're so preoccupied with tech and traditional framing of entrepreneurs, we often completely ignore very, very successful women. So we really have to work on those images, and we have to really crack open where the barriers are. So, you know, I say this, and I say this to the minister who funds the Women Entrepreneurship Knowledge Hub and the Women Entrepreneurship Strategy and the Black Entrepreneurship Strategy. It's great that we have those targets. It's great that we're putting, you know, targeted funding into women entrepreneurs, Black entrepreneurs. But it is a drop in the bucket compared to the overall investments we're putting into innovation, economic development, et cetera. You know, some of the banks stand up and pound their chests and say, oh, we are running a program, there's $100,000 women can apply for. You know, it's every single level. It's the financial institutions, it's government agencies, it's organizations that procure product. They really have to move beyond, as I said, you know, grand gestures and rainbow posters and start to put their money where their mouth is.
Thank you. And to, yes. and to be consistent with the follow-through. Like you said, we can't just have it be the surface level anymore. There's, when we look at the tech layoffs and when we look at the DEI areas that are just being chopped after they were established only 2 years ago following George Floyd's murder, and this really goes to show how companies are valuing this side of things.
I just wanted to contribute one other point to the earlier conversation as well, which isn't the answer to your question, but we also have to meet people where they are. And I have become, you know, I grew up poor as well in a single family, have experienced intergenerational trauma, etc. But I recognize my privilege, and I recognize the differences from where I stand and my, you know, the opportunities my daughter has, for example, compared to others. And so while I, you know, grew up in an environment where, you know, my failures were always reframed as success, so like, I don't get the imposter syndrome stuff because it wasn't part of my upbringing, I see such differences based on the individual experiences that people have had that I think we really have to be careful. And just one anecdote, Black Business Professional Association runs something called Boss Women. And you know, I do the workshops. And we were doing a workshop and one woman asked a question and said she was the third time she was taking it. And I spoke to Nadine Spencer afterwards and I said, like, this is not a course where you're getting tested. Like, why is she taking it over and over and over again? And what Nadine explained is because Black women so often feel like they don't belong. The benefit to her from the course was not how to read a financial statement or do a business plan. It was the community, it was the network, it was the people saying, you can do this, you can do this, you can do this. And while that was a very alien experience for me, it made me realize that when we're trying to support women entrepreneurs, we really have to be attentive to meeting them where they are.
Mm-hmm. And to understanding that, yes. And to understanding that sometimes the initial resistance is a lack of trust. I don't trust so many spaces that I enter. I inherently, just from my lived experience, the wall is up. And it takes a while for me to know, okay, I'm in a space where I can actually be 10% of my authentic self or a little bit more of that. And to be able to trust yourself in those situations can be really hard. And so if we have to go back multiple times to feel uplifted, to feel seen, to feel in community, it's because we finally found a space where we can be ourselves. And so I know that in my own body to the fullness of that. So something that also comes up when we think about this is we're able to openly talk about mental health here. And this is something that's really impactful, but it's not always the case in all the spaces that we enter into. It's not always safe for us to talk about what's really on our mind. My husband and I talk about this often, how for men, mental health is a very taboo topic even now. So even though we are so well-versed in our emotions, in our EI, this isn't necessarily something, and not to stereotype this, but there's still so much work to be done. So I'm being given the wrap-up of the panel, but a question that if we could briefly just go across the panel to share is, if there was one piece of like just what you wish you could say to someone if you were their hype human of, we are facing challenge and I want you to persevere, what would that be to the women and folks in this room? Silken, we'll start with you and then we'll come across this way.
Yeah, I guess I would start with that Olympic athlete mentality, right? Which is creating a vision of what you want. And I think that feeds into a lot of the comments I've heard on the panel today. Don't focus on what you don't want. Don't focus on how overwhelming the problem is. You know, I represented Canada so proudly for 16 years internationally, and now, you know, the pandemic, a lot of other things, I really recognize, you know, not only how privileged I am, but so many of the things that I have not to be proud of in this country, and racism and the way that we've treated our First Peoples is definitely one of those things, and I'm reckoning all those things, you know, all the time in my mind and heart and in my actions. And I think that when I'm looking, so I work in the mental health space. We have a story sharing site. We run councils, peer-to-peer support. I truly believe in the power of story to move people along their journey, to meet people wherever they are. And it's so important that we see ourselves in each other. So we really try to create environments with people who've had all sorts of challenges in their life, people who look different from one another and have had different experiences. So I think that the way forward, first of all, each of us are leaders. If you're an entrepreneur, you're leading something. And when we are challenged, whatever we're challenged with, if it's racism, if it's sexism, if it's mental health, the opportunity to share that challenge and have an impact is so much more because we are leaders. When I wrote my personal story of growing up with a mom with an undiagnosed mental illness and all the difficulties that that entailed in my own mental health issues, I was terrified to share that story because of the stigma, because of changing people's perception of who they thought I was. But to stand in my truth, to you talked about story and the importance of being authentic and knowing your story, knowing how trauma has affected you, all of those things. But then to share it in with the aim and the intention and the open-heartedness to help other people. So I see this in this room today, the Economic Club, Green Shield sponsoring this event, you know, has created a space where this is not just a normal business lunch. We're really sharing so openly. So as we move forward in our professional paths, whatever that might be, in our charitable paths, whatever it might be, adopting that mentality of that importance of being open-hearted, allowing yourself to be vulnerable. It actually takes a ton of courage to be vulnerable, but you will impact another human being. And to build on just a couple comments across the board was just about the lifting up. Women are so damn competitive with one another, and it is just so destructive. And maybe that's just instinct, like I don't know where it comes from, but let's say we'll never really figure that piece out, but let's push against that. And whenever we feel jealousy or competitiveness or they have it all, she has it all, push against that and recognize there's another human being in front of you with a very different experience and problems and challenges and maybe self-worth issues. There's no way you can recognize by first glance. Everything might look and seem perfect. Offer one another love, compassion, and encouragement. When women really start to lift each other up powerfully, systemically, things are going to start to change.
Thank you so much, Sophie. And next up, Rhiannon, what is on your heart most to say to folks here?
Yeah, absolutely. I want to say that the system, as Wendy so eloquently said, is broken. We know that. We've seen evidence of that. Our systems are sick right now. Our planet's sick, and many of us are sick. We're all one connected organism. So just look at Mother Earth to see the reflection back of our systems being a little bit out of balance. In nature, there are cycles and seasons. In business, there needs to be cycles and seasons. Progress at all cost at the expense of people and planet just isn't working anymore, and it won't work. But the only way that we're going to be able to collectively change something that feels so massive, and it really truly is, it's overwhelming and can give you poor mental health to even think about it at some moment, is to actually take it back to our individual opportunity as each and every one of us to be able to think about one thing, which is ourselves. In our own circle, in our own household, in our own family, what can we start to do to put one foot in front of the other to get the support we need, the healing that we need? Our actual physiology, so I never thought about how important just sleep and food and like going pee when I need to. I know that sounds so strange, but we literally override all the signals in our body as people who are in this system that is constantly just thinking about our productivity. And so again, I know like this doesn't feel like a normal Economic Club of Canada lunch. I hope it is. I hope this becomes the norm. I hope, because these are the real economic issues. And we're seeing it right now with the mass resignation. We're seeing it right now with the she session. We're seeing it right now with all the different pieces that are coming up. And the big, you know, people at the top, the boards, the CEOs, they're feeling it too. That pressure is real too. We're all a part of this. We have a different, unique place that we occupy, but we're all a part of this. So again, I think it really comes back down to your own individual way that you can think about your well-being and yourself, and that will have the ripple effect, never mind about solving everything else outside of you, because whatever you can do inside of you will impact your community, your family, your friends. You know, people used to know me and it was like, let's open a king can with my, you know, tooth on the weekend and let loose. And now it's different. We do meditation. We, you know, go on hikes in nature. We find new ways to connect, and it's nourishing. And it nourishes my business, and it nourishes the other relationships that I have. So I think that there are ways, and it's mind, body, spirit. We've lost our connection to spirit, to our essence, to our higher connection of all things. And you can call that whatever you want. It doesn't have to be in a religious institution model, but it absolutely exists. And we need to remember that. That's it.
Thank you, Rhiannon. And I'm actually going to round out with Rachel. If you could give us like a very brief, because we're getting the final wrap here.
Wow, it's hard to follow. I agree with everything that you guys said. I guess I just want to maybe wrap up. If I had to speak to someone and say, stop waiting for someone's permission to shine and be yourself and be authentic. I don't need to assess the room and decide how authentic I can be. I could just be me. Whoever likes me, whoever doesn't. Not yes. Everybody will like us. Not everybody will see our potential. Not everybody will help push us upward. But when you run into that one person, and that one person who's going to lift you up, next time you might be that person who's going to lift someone else up. So when you see potential, when you encourage people to be themselves, they will give you the best of themselves. And so that's my message, is just be you, surround yourself with people who recognize your worth yourself first, obviously, but surround yourself with the right people. And then when it's your turn to give back, go ahead and do it. That's my message to women.
Thank you so much, everyone. And I hope that after today's event, we're all gonna be chewing on the things that we talked about, that you call someone who matters to you, and that you tell them a little bit about what you learned so that you just feel connected to your people as well and a little bit uplifted today. So thank you, everybody. This was such a wonderful conversation. Enjoy the rest of the afternoon.
And so I am going to introduce to you two of our incredible artists in residence. So Madeline Kirby and Your Honey are going to perform for us two incredible songs. And I also just want to acknowledge their leadership in the space of wellness and creativity. They have co-founded an organization called Write the Feeling. And Write the Feeling is a workshop that you could have at your organization, or you could attend one that they do in the city, where they actually allow people to start to use creative writing as an expression for wellness. It's a really beautiful modality. I've attended many of their workshops, and I'm really proud of the both of them and the work that they do. So it is a true honor to open up this stage and the floor to Your Honey and Madeline Kirby.
Thank you, Rhiannon. Thank you. Sorry, we're so honored to be here in a room full of so many change makers. This next song that we're going to do for you is an original. Kind of. Okay.
Still happening. I'm going to turn it on. Yeah, let's try that.
To the stars in June, like a flower in full bloom. Right home to the olive trees, to the fields where we cried at 13. To the water we cry. When you and I were making bad decisions, we lied. But it feels so far where we were to who we are. In the place where I was born, where I learned to walk, where I told you I was yours, got punched in the teeth for dressing my way, learned how to drink so I wouldn't feel anything, no pain. Stars in June, like a flower in full bloom.
Thank you.
This next song is a cover. It's by a band called Big Thief, and it's called Change. You smile forever, never cry.
the sun. Never watch the moon rising. Would you walk forever in the light? To never learn the secret of the quiet night. Like a stone, like a hill, like home. Still, what I find is you are always on my mind. Could I feel happy for you when I hear you talk? You holding her the way you once held me. Change like the sky, like the leaves, like a butterfly. Death like a door to a place we've never been before. While everything around passes, would you smile forever, never cry?
Thank you.
Thank you very much to Madeline Kirby and Your Honey. I don't know about all of you, but an acoustic guitar and some female vocalists, it's a pretty sweet jam and a great way to break up the afternoon. So thanks to Lunar Studios and Rhiannon. That was a great addition, I think, to today's event. A round of applause for them. All right, so back to the rest of our agenda for today. I have the honor of introducing our next panel. It is on women of color and the myth of having it all. So I'd like to introduce you to all. Thanks. Our moderator for the panel is going to be Harriet Ekapedrin, right? Close. Vice President, Mental Health of Green Shield Canada, and our panelists that will be joining her are Carlin Purcell, CEO of KTPM Consulting, founder of Sister Talk and Wellness Academy Group, Alice Kyung, Independent Corporate Director and Board Member at Green Shield, and Julie Caffley from Catalyst, who is also an Executive Director there. So welcome aboard, ladies. Love to have you join us up here.
Testing. Can you all hear me?
No. I need a cushion.
Can you hear me now? I guess not. Okay, thank you. Do you want to test yours and just see?
Testing? Testing?
Alice is working.
Hello?
No. We might need another one because it's
not working.
Testing? Yeah, I think you're going to.
Yeah?
I think so.
Oh, the lights.
Yeah, bright lights.
Yeah. Okay, I guess we'll turn this off. So I should turn it off?
Yes, your turn on. Yours works.
Yeah, mine works.
Yours
works. Okay.
Testing? Testing? Can you hear me at the back? We'll get there. Better? Excellent. Okay. Thank you all so much. I hope you all enjoyed your lunch. And we have an amazing trio of women here today. And I don't know about you, but that last panel had me in tears. I had to stop myself from ruining my mascara. So this topic is called Women of Color. In the workplace, the myth of having it all. And I think that means different things to different people. And I'd like to start by just asking each of you what that means to you. I'm gonna start with Carlin and then Alice, and we'll go to Julie.
Good afternoon, everyone. Such a pleasure to be here. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay, awesome. Women of color, the myth of having it all. For me, it means that we can't have it all, not all at the same time. And secondly, we can't have it all in a way that really centers our full dignity and respect as women of color until we address the elephant in the room, the elephant in the heteronormative patriarchal room, the elephant in the white body supremacy room, the elephant in the room in terms of the culture of white feminism here in Canada and also globally as well. So I think we can have it all when we come together and address those elephants in the room.
I have to disclose that I never liked the expression having it all. Not even when it first came out in the 80s, I'm dating myself. The reason why I don't like it is that it actually defines what success should be for women. All of us, we all want the same thing. We want a career, we want family, we want money, and so forth. I don't think that it is correct or it's appropriate to assume that all of us want the same thing. But because it's out there, we have to strive for that. And what I particularly don't like about that expression, it really puts all the burden of achieving success on my shoulder and on all women's shoulders. I don't like it. It also trivializes some of the challenges that you talked about, is that there are a lot of inequities out there, pay inequities, access to reasonable housing, access to safe and good childcare, and access to parental leave. It assumes that that's really you to deal with. So I don't like having it all for those reasons.
Great.
Yeah, thank you for the question. Obviously for me, I don't have the lived experience, and yet there's nothing that is more important to me. I work with Catalyst Canada that focuses on inclusive workplaces for all. And when we look at the situations for racialized women in the workplace, there's an enormous emotional tax, and there's frankly a lot to do. Coming out of the pandemic, we're looking at 60% of racialized women who are ready to leave their job because they don't feel that they can show up as their authentic selves at work. So this is a huge issue for me every single day of my life in my new job at Catalyst Canada, and it couldn't be more important.
Great, thank you, Julie. I think once he's done, thank you. I think we would be remiss if we didn't address the elephant in the room, having brought up that topic, Colin, the fact that many of us in the audience are probably thinking, well, this panel is supposed to be about women of color, so what's Julie doing up here? And I think that your organization is doing some really profound work. And so for those of us who may not be familiar with Catalyst, could you tell us about what your organization does?
Absolutely, thank you for asking. Catalyst Canada has existed for 60 years, and our very core mission is to build more inclusive workplaces for women. So through pay equity, through ensuring safe work environments for inclusivity at all different levels of the organization. And in fact, I was interested about the previous conversation because we have traditionally focused more on women in leadership, and now we have a whole new initiative looking at frontline workers and all of the racial issues and all of the gender issues related to frontline work as well. So really at every level of the organization, how is inclusivity affecting us, and how does every single organization need to have it as a core part of their strategy?
And if I can just add, I told Julie the story earlier. I really thank Catalyst. During my 20 years working in the financial industry on Bay Street, I remember when the research came out on emotional attacks, and I had never felt more seen and more heard and more validated, right? Because you don't know what you're going through because you don't have the language for it. And then the research came out and I was so excited. But my one pet peeve though with Catalyst at the time was that a lot of the events around women of color was being done only in the US. So I was that annoying person who emailed organizations and be like, so when are you holding something for Canada? So it's so great to see how the work has extended, and just to let you know that there is an impact on the employee level as well.
I think we'll talk about emotional tax, because I'm sure that some of us are unfamiliar with that term, so we'll talk a little bit about that. But leading into that, Carlin, I think when you talk about emotional tax, something happened with you when you were working in the banking industry, right? There was a CBC article or CBC interview that you did, and you spoke about certain situations that you found yourself in. Can you tell us a bit more about the situation, how that made you feel, the impact of your mental health, and what you did to kind of move away from that situation and start to feel better about it?
Yeah, it's, you know, working in an environment where you are, you know, the minority, sometimes you question your experiences. And I remember having a conversation with one of my colleagues who happened to be white, and she shared how, you know, I've never had to, you know, apply for a job. I just, you know, get a referral, and she's been getting promotions, you know, over the years. And I put my hand up for an introduction to another department that I wanted to go into, and I'm sitting at the table speaking to this senior leader who also happened to be white, and she looked me up and down, and at the time, I don't think I had extensions, but I think I had my natural hair, and she said, well, people who work in our department are well-groomed. And I sat there, because, you know, sometimes you're like, did I hear her right? You know, did I? And I sat there, and you know when you wish the ground would open up and you would just disappear? Because I also did not have the courage to ask and say, well, is it my hair? Is it the color of my skin? And the culture within the workplaces, it's ripped and it's rooted in gaslighting. So I didn't want to bring up, is it because of the color of my skin, right? Because then you get the question of, why do you always have to make everything about race? Right? So that was one example. There was another example where I was teased about my accent as well. I'm from the Caribbean. I'm from St. Lucia, Nupali Patois. I speak, you know, my ancestral language. I speak two different languages. Anybody from St. Lucia here? No? Hey! We've got three of us here. And I do the one thing they tell you not to do, right? Which is, you can't cry at work. What did I do? I went to the bathroom and I cried, right? Because I felt at that time, and not only did she tease me about my accent, she stood up and she said, did you hear how she said that word? Like, that particular employee actually said that out loud. And it really crushed me. And this was also when I realized that I had to stop being loyal to an organization who didn't care about my psychological well-being, right? I had to put myself first. And what came out of that was me starting a women's group called Sister Talk Leadership and Wellness Academy. I got really interested in vulnerability. How can I bring my full self to work, but also how can I still protect myself? And actually, that's how we ended up being on Oprah's Live Class, asking Dr. Brené Brown, can we bring vulnerability into the workplace? And if so, how? So I have to say kudos to you, Green Shield, and your organization for modeling what it looks like to create healthy and psychologically safe workspaces by having this conversation today.
That's amazing. Thank you for sharing that. And you know, last week I was just telling Rhiannon that last week I was asked by Green Shield to speak to our women's enterprise resource group. And I had gotten the questions ahead of time, and I, you know, as we do, practice the questions in front of the mirror. And when I got there, I just thought, no, I don't want to say that. And I sought their permission to be vulnerable. And I thought, we're in a group of women, and me as an executive, they're looking up to me, thinking, you know, Harriet is the VP, and we have to aspire to that. But no, I'm just human, right? So your point about vulnerability, it's a superpower that we don't recognize. And I'm sure that many of us in the room today were sobbing our eyes out, trying not to make our mascara run down our cheeks when we heard Rhiannon and when we heard Silken speak. And there's just such great power in being authentic. So thank you for bringing that to our attention. Yeah. So Alice, we've talked about vulnerability. I'm sure that you're thinking, you know, you've been in this area for a long time, over 30 years in leadership. And I'm sure that you've seen many, many changes over the years, from when we couldn't cry at work to when we're sobbing at the Economic Club and GSE, you know, event. Can you share with us some of your experiences when you started your career many years ago? What's changed and what do you think is left to be done?
Oh, so much to be done. So I have been around for a long time. And first of all, before I even answer the question, it is so gratifying to see so many of you in this room that we have partners, we have people who are willing to share their experiences, their vulnerability, their wisdom. As a member of the Green Shield board, I am just so proud and so gratified that that the social impact work that the organization is doing is really reaping, you know, impact. So I'm very, very happy. Back to the question, I had a long career, I have to say. I retired in October 2020, and it was in the middle of the pandemic. There was a lot of celebration online to pay tribute to my contribution. And one of my mentors actually referred to me as a trailblazer for women. And I was a bit surprised by that. I just kind of always did my thing. But upon reflection of my 40-some years of a career life, I realized that I did break barriers. Not one, not two, quite a few barriers. After business school, I joined Air Canada into the finance department. Yes, the airline is full of women, but they are all in the, you know, in flight services, not really in the leadership rank. I hate to tell you, at the time, we didn't even have a women washroom in the executive dining room. In the 90s, I joined an organization that is into manufacturing and distribution, and same thing, you walk down the manufacturing floor, it's full of men and women of colors, but you walk through the door into the offices, there was me, and there was a lady, the kind lady that fetched me coffee that is of color. So I'm glad that things have changed. And very often I find myself to be alone at the table. And do I resent it? Yes, sometimes, but I'm glad that I'm at the table as opposed to be outside the door and pounding it, trying to get in. Yes, I was kind of a token so that the organization that I work in can actually tick the box. Okay, we got one. Good, job done. That's what DEI is about. And I'm glad to see that today we don't do that and we ask companies, what have you done? What impact? What lives have you impacted? And that's what really Green Shield does. I am thankful for the women before me because they helped to lift me up And one of the things that I always remember throughout my my career is to make sure that I do the same. To your point about paying forward, helping other women, lift them up, whether they're in the room or not in the room, because it's important that we help each other. I am glad that things have changed. Not at the pace that I would like. So this is what we are here to do.
We have a lot to learn from you. We have a lot to learn from you. So on that, keeping on that topic of change, Julie, in a recent study by Catalyst, there was a study that was done that showed that 700 women and men of color reported a worrisome emotional tax, and we'll come back to this emotional tax. But I think when we speak about these issues, we're all very much familiar with what the issues are, but I'd like to focus on what are the solutions, right? It's important. I think that's what's more important than actually focusing on the issues. And so you found some ways of how we can mitigate some of these emotional tax. So can you tell us a bit more about what emotional tax is for those of us that aren't familiar and what employees can do to mitigate this?
Emotional tax, I think if we think about it, we all instinctively know. It's showing up and feeling that you can be yourself at work, that you're not feeling protected because of your gender, because of your background, because of many things that you might carry in your backpack to work every day. It might be an invisible disability, it might be many things, and that you can actually show up and be yourself. And of course, women have much more of an emotional tax in the workplace, and racialized women even more so. And so we're looking at, I did get the statistics specifically for women, and it's 60%. And this leads directly to retention issues. It leads to people leaving organizations. We have a recent study that says that over 60% of women of color want to leave their organization today. They're thinking of leaving their organization. They're not feeling like it's a safe space for them, and they want to move on. 60%. And obviously, that's devastating to everyone in the room, and there's no way that we can work in workplaces where 60% of women in color want to leave their organizations. And so how can we create safe spaces? You know, it's not rocket science. It's about empathy. It's about inclusivity. It's about listening. It's about bringing your authentic self to work. And it sounds very, very simple, and yet there's just enormous work to do in this area.
I know that Catalyst is also doing some work around holding CEOs accountable, right?
So, absolutely, yeah. Yes. We have an initiative called CEO Champions for Change, and it ensures that there's frankly representation. There's transparency in terms of data regarding representation, and there's certain numbers around the number of women on both leadership teams and on boards, and also specifically around racialized women. So ensuring that there is representation at those very senior levels of the organization. So there's a certain requirement to be met to be considered a Catalyst CEO Champions for Change.
That's amazing. Yeah. That's amazing. So Carlin, in keeping with what people are doing, like what Catalyst is doing, I know that your organization is also doing some work around this area, working with leaders and leadership to speak openly about emotional tax and what it's doing for the doing to their employees. Can you give us a little bit more information about what you're doing specifically for women of color?
Yeah, absolutely. And with the stats too, right? One of my I don't call it a pet peeve, but one of the things I struggle with when we talk about representation as one of the solutions, I find it's an incomplete statement, because representation without psychological safety, you're creating more harm.
True.
Right? Because when we look at, you know, yes, you might bring in one person, but do they feel safe enough to speak up? Are their dignity and respect being centered? And when you do have an over-representation of whiteness, whether it's in the C-suite or on teams, then what you end up happening is that the culture, the container of culture, is not rooted in the cultural, you know, confidence and also the cultural or the ancestral wisdom of that particular person or group, right? Because you can't really create culture with just one person, right? Like Alice has been the one person for so long, and I can understand you feeling that resentment.
At least she has her own washroom now, though.
I mean, yes, absolutely. So what we did, you know, at KDPM Group, and we took that on our own, because, and then we're vulnerable, right? We're keeping it real here, right? there's something very dehumanizing about explaining to a CEO, whether the, you know, white CEO, male, female, about why we need to justify creating a report on psychological safety for black women in the workplace. You know what I mean? So we took it up on our own, and I took my own money, and I did a study together with York University, so grateful for Dr. Monique and Dr. Julie and the Department of Psychology. And what we did was that we brought, you know, black women from different industries, and we did a research on what do you need for you to actually feel safe at work? What does a container look like? Because we know as companies, you know, activate and implement their DEI plans, culture will not change overnight, right? Culture is something that it takes time for it to shift. It takes time for it to change. And if we're meeting people where they are, it means that every single person is on a different path in terms of their learning and also their unlearning as well. So how can we create safer containers for black women? And of course, the intent is for us to go beyond and to also look at women of color as well. But for phase one, I thought it was very important for us to give black women a voice, because black women usually don't have a voice, you know, just on our own. We're usually lumped in with women of color, which is great because we know we're all fighting for the same thing. But it's important to understand what it is we're really struggling with. And what the research showed, just gonna share, and we will be releasing the full report next year, in terms of the finding, I mean, later on this year, was, of course, you know, limited sense of belonging, right? Mm-hmm. Because of not having that psychologically safe container. Managemental leadership outcomes was a big thing, because quite a number of people of color and women of color end up reporting to leaders who do not have the cultural competency in terms of understanding the structural barriers that women of color face. And because we don't have the majority of the voice, then we don't have the data as well to support it. But I'm also very cautious about, you know, asking or getting more data, because we're all datted out as well, right? Because it's there. I remember seeing a report from the Diversity Institute when I was working at the bank, and maybe I was like 10 years in, and it showed that the numbers for women of color didn't shift much. I think it moved like, in the decade they did the new report, it shifted maybe like 0.001%. And I felt so disappointed, because to your point, we do all this research, we have all this data, but are we shifting behavior? Mm. And I think what's missing, and what the research showed, was in terms of management or leadership outcomes, a lot of leaders who are leading others do not have the cultural competency, they do not have the support also, because again, the bottom line, right? We wanna hit those numbers. But I often say that you can't hit those numbers if you're not centering the people who are actually doing the work. And the last thing that we also saw, the research showed, was dismissal of ideas and value of contributions. So a lot of black women and women of color, I mean, we're afraid to share our ideas in the workplace, because you end up being dismissed or undermined, because half of the time, the unconscious racial bias component, again, from a behavioral strategy, is not addressed. So you have, I don't want to say, you know, not incompetent managers, but a lot of managers who don't have the full skill set. They are really trained to just manage from a homophily perspective, meaning that they know how to lead people who look like them, right? Affinity bias, all those biases are a huge part of our leadership and management practices. And if we are to create better workplaces for the future of work, we also need to address those behaviors. Address it, the elephant in the leadership room, but also, I think, was it Silken who said it earlier, like us women coming together, I also want to be honest and speak to white people specifically in the room and say, get your girls and get your people, let's do better. Because you do have the majority in terms of the support and the people you have around you, and the only way for us to break those barriers is for us to be really honest, and I think we're here, right? That's why Green Shield is here to support us.
That's great, because yeah. I think...
That's great.
To your point, the data does help, right? Yeah. So the data helps in so many aspects. And we know that, you know, even during the pandemic, when you look at racialized data, they weren't being collected. And when we started collecting those data, we knew that there was something fundamentally wrong in what we're seeing and how the pandemic is affecting people of color compared to others, right? And until we have that data, it's really difficult to do something about it. But this is the time to act. Getting the data is one thing, but having the data just for data's sake is not good enough, right? Yeah. Yeah. So Alice, I have a gripe with you. So when you worked at eHealth Ontario as the COO, you were known as a no-nonsense leader, right? And I remember a particular situation where I was, my manager was away and I had to go and meet Alice and provide the status, and I was shitting myself. And I had this overwhelming anxiety as to, you know, what was I gonna say? What was I gonna do? What was I gonna wear? And, you know, I want to say I was young, not stupid, because I've never been stupid, even though I do say so myself, but I was young and I was vulnerable then, and I was very anxious. But I think I learned so much from you, and I think I'd like you to kind of share the wisdom at how women, especially women of color, can be composed in situations like that, because we find ourselves so often in a room where we're the only women, or with only women of color. Yeah. And before I ask my question, there was another situation at eHealth Ontario, and there were probably like 8 of us in the room, and I was the only woman and the only person of color in the room. And I was sat at the back, and all the men were, you know, talking about how great their ideas were, and I just sat there. And I have a nursing degree, so the first thing I do when I enter a room is I assess. I assess the situation and determine who's stupid and who is worth listening to. And they just kept on talking, and then I said something, and they all turned and looked at me. And I thought, I'm my mother's child. And I said, yes, I'm a woman, I have a voice, and I'm gonna use it. And not many people can do that, right? Not many people can do that. And I think that I learned so much from you as a COO. This is not an opportunity for me to seek intervention, although it could be. But I'd really like to get your thoughts and, you know, having been in this industry for so long, how you can, the wisdom that you can pass on to younger women that find themselves in the situation that I was in, where we're so anxious and work is so anxiety-provoking to the point of burnout.
Yeah. Actually, there's a little YouTube thing called Pearl, P-U-R-L. If ever anybody interested, look at it. And it was like, you know, all men, and then this little woman come in. What are you supposed to do? Act like them, dress like them, talk like them, or be yourself? And so I recommend, it's a little thing. It's very interesting that our description of men leaders and women leaders are very different. If you look at, and this is not even talking psychology or sociology, but we use different words to describe the same attributes, the same characters in men compared to women leaders. Men will be described as analytical, big picture guy, assertive, you know, really strategic, and everybody loves him. But women with the same attributes would be pushy, that's really a bit vain, and bossy, and not listening, and as you have given some example, oh, there she goes again, right? So there is this built-in bias. So there's two kinds of bias. One is that we expect and we attach certain attributes and we associate it with certain community. That social group, that community, that gender, this is what we think that they are. And if you don't fit that, wow, we don't know what to do with you. That's why your boss said, why are you speaking up? You know, we didn't expect you to be speaking up. It's not your turn yet. I want to listen to the guys. And the other one is that expectation. If you are different than what we think you should be, then now we got a problem. And not to mention about the unconscious bias, because people might not say this. That's the reason why you don't get invited to the room. That's because there's built-in bias. I think we need to be aware of that. And I just love, you know, the panel before and the panel now, you know, and including yourself, Harriet, to have effort and initiatives to help other women to deal with that kind of built-in biases. What would be my advice to young emerging, you know, women leaders? I would say that just know yourself, be confident, okay? Don't let others, you know, decide what you should be like, how you should talk, how you should dress, how you should present the idea. So be confident. Now, and also when you are meeting with somebody who's no nonsense, don't just listen to the water cooler talk. You know, go talk to your contact, your people you trust. Is she really like that? You know, how did you get your idea sold last time? Talk to your network. Find out for yourself. And in terms of confidence, you know what I do? If I'm unsure and I'm going to talk to and pitch an idea to a big boss, a man or a woman, I go back to my office and I pull down my latest CV and I take a look at that. And I go, man, look at your accomplishments. You did this, you did that. Remember, we did all this. And you are worried about tomorrow doing that presentation? And just remember, you're the guy who knows more than everybody in that room. So the thing is, dumb it down, bring them with you to the conclusion you want them to reach. And remember, okay, be yourself.
Thank you. Thank you. That was a mini therapy session for me. So that was really helpful. Thank you so much. And, you know, I think that over the weekend I was watching a movie. I just fancied something that was, you know, chick flick. And I was watching How Does She Do It? I don't even remember the name of it. And there was a quote that said, you know, trying to be a man is a waste of a woman. And I just had to rewind it and listen to it again a couple of times because I just loved it. I just loved it. And everything that you've all said, especially Alice, what you said about, you know, our perception of the successful man and a man in leadership versus a successful woman and the woman in leadership is very different. And I think we all strive to be the man, consciously or unconsciously, right? But it really is true. Trying to be a man is a waste of a woman. And I think we really need to remember that. Right, so and I see Allison giving me the side eye, so I'm gonna take it to our last question. And for each of you, I would like you to kind of leave us with a takeaway, especially for those of us that are up and coming in the room in our leadership positions. And for you, Alice, I'd like for you to kind of touch on some advice that you would give to younger women and women of color who are trying to get on boards, because we know, based on, you know, Wendy spoke about earlier around the disparity of people on the board, and even when they are women, they're usually, you know, white women. And I'd love to get some thoughts from you as to what advice you would give to young women of color that are trying to get on boards.
So first of all, I think it applies to your career, not just the board, because in your career, you want to make sure that you're all-rounded. So whether you're a lawyer or a nurse or a financial analyst, you need to round out your competency, because most boards are looking for the perfect competency and skill mix. So you need to make sure that you fulfill that. And same thing for your career as you climb the corporate ladder. I mean, I will tell you a few things that it worked for me, I think, and hopefully that they still work. And I think everyone on the panel before and this one had sort of touched it. I'm looking at you and I'm looking at you and you, is passion. You know, have the passion in what you do, really believe in it, right? And you know, if you're passionate about it, it just makes it so much easier and success will come, so enjoy it. And the second thing is about taking risks. Wow, you know, from a big bang to starting your own business, it's about taking risk and believe in yourself and don't let other people define you, because it's very easy to listen to all those little voices. Oh, you know, I'm a fraud, I shouldn't be here. And don't let that, and don't pull yourself out of races too soon, right? So take risks, because every set of challenges has its own set of opportunities. So you need to do that. And lastly is, and we don't do this enough, and this is a wonderful opportunity, allyship is a key concept in DEI. And strategic networking. Believe me, it's not a waste of time. I am I could attest to that. It got good ROI, okay? So other people have talked about having mentors. You don't want one mentor, you want as many as possible, because it's set of problems, needs a mentor. And you need advocates and you need sponsors. Guess what? Because you are not in every room at every table. And when the story is spinning about you, you want your advocate and you want your sponsor to speak on your behalf, okay? So we need to work together and help each other.
Thank you, such wise words. When we spoke during the pre-panel, and the first panel spoke about this and imposter syndrome, and you know, when I found myself in this room having to give the status update with Alice, I could say that I felt a sense of imposter syndrome. But Carlin, you when we spoke briefly pre-panel, you do not subscribe to that terminology, and mm-hmm. I think it's really important to kind of share with us why, and for people in the room to kind of hear your take on things.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, if we know that language precedes behavior, right? Thoughts become mm-hmm. things, and beliefs are thoughts we repeat over and over again, right? So for me, saying I'm an imposter, I'm actually setting myself up for failure. I'm not a fraud. I'm a goddess. I'm a child of a queen, like, you know? but you know, from a, you know, mindset perspective, when we think about imposter syndrome, the phenomenon, it is influenced by the systemic structures that have excluded us out of many rooms. So it's actually, you know, an intuitive, a powerful tool for us to, you feel like you don't belong, quote unquote, your values are simply telling you that, hey, I don't feel totally psychologically safe in this space. And that's important data. This is why I always say emotions are data. Right? And when we talk historically about imposter syndrome, a lot of the pressure, just as Alice mentioned, it's on women. Same thing about having it all. It's on us. But so I don't like the word, and I would like for us to evolve it. Because if we do so, we create more capacity and more space for us to have real conversations about what's getting in the way. I have self-doubt. That's a more accurate description, because we do. We all have self-doubt. I have self-doubt. The brain has a negativity bias. So that self-doubt comes from that. But I don't like saying I'm an imposter, and I wish we would stop saying that. We can acknowledge the phenomenon, but we're not imposters. We're powerful, strong, brilliant women and men and humans and people who are doing everything we can to make this world a better place, and we should acknowledge that.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Julie, I'm going to give you probably the, depends on how much side eye I get, but probably the last word on this. And I'd love for you to give us some, you know, a takeaway for leaders, because you guys at Catalyst, you're doing this work, right? You're training people and you're pulling people along, leaders along, and how to create a more psychologically safe workplace. So can you give us, to the leaders in the room, some advice as to how to start to move the dial?
Absolutely. We just did a pulse check with 14,000 people in four different countries, including Canada, and 75% of employees don't believe the organization's racial equity policies. They don't believe it. They think it's bullshit. And so we've got to change that. We've got to show up authentically. We've got to do more. We're failing in terms of racial equity policies because the employees are just not believing it. So I think that's the call to action. That's where we really need to make change. And I think the three of you are just amazing models in terms of all of that. So I'm just deeply grateful to be here with you today.
And can I just add one more thing before we go? We're talking about, you know, women of color. We're talking about mental health. We're talking about the impact of all the other residual things that comes out of that. And one of the things that I'd like to say is menstrual equity. And I want to shout out Wellness by Saran. Saran is doing some incredible work. I'm here because of my community. Table 10, where's Table 10? Can you wave? These are some incredible healers in the Black community. And Table 11, as Alice mentioned, we can't do this work without advocates. So I want organizations to start thinking about your workplace wellness perspective from a holistic perspective, not what you inherited. Menstrual equity has been left off the table for so many years, and we need to bring it back into the conversation. And men, just get comfortable with it, please. Right? Get comfortable with it. Have conversations with your children, your nieces, your nephews, your other colleagues and friends. I think we can shift and change the dial if we continue to have braver conversation and give ourselves permission to be more courageous with our hearts.
And I have a challenge for everybody. After today's session, when you go back to your organization, you need to make sure that you work with the organization and your team to raise awareness, awareness about mental health and mental well-being for women of color, for marginal communities, because that's the one thing we have learned from the pandemic, that they are disproportionately being impacted. So you have to do your job, because this is a time we want to start rethink what the future of work is, what the future of workplace is. This is a great opportunity for you to make the difference, shape the future for all of us.
Thank you, thank you, thank you so much for this incredible panel. You know, it's, I think, you know, when we talk about the women in the workplace, women of color in the workplace and the support, I don't think that we can do this without the support of men, right? So the men in our lives, thank you. Thank you to my husband first, before Joe. And thank you, Zahid. And you know, like yesterday, I think I was telling, I don't know who I was telling it yet last night, I was trying to figure out what to wear, and I thought, okay, we're gonna wear this skirt, but what about this top? And then I said to my husband, can I wear your shirt? And he said, yes. And I said, can you iron it for me? So, you know, women are beautiful, women are complex, and women of color, we sometimes have to work 2-3 times as hard to get a seat at the table. And with the help and support of men and others around the community, I think that we can't have it all, but we can get pretty darn close. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
There we go. Better? So it's been a pretty insightful day so far. Thank you, Harriet. Thank you, ladies. That was an incredible, incredible panel. We're almost at the close, I think, of today's session. But there's a few nuggets I think that we should maybe just touch on. I think it started with Zahid and the origin story. That really hit home. It's so often very difficult to pinpoint exactly where things started. And that was a phenomenal origin story that you shared with us on how Green Shield kind of was born. To Silken and her comment, which really stuck with me, which was that damn word perfection and us actually destroying it. We all struggle with it and we need to, you know, really get that out of our vocabulary. And Alice, I'm thinking about how do I channel everything that she was saying and get access into it every single day. And I'm sure many of you are thinking the exact same thing. So that's what my take was from many of today, and hopefully it helps inform my story and my narrative, which is not yet written and will change today, change tomorrow, and probably change 10 years down the road. And I look for all of you to help support each other and myself in actually creating that narrative for ourselves. So without further ado, I'm going to leave it up to our EVP of Human Resources and Social Impact at Green Shield. So Mila Lucio, I'd like to welcome you to close us out for today, please.
So, wow. What an impressive group of women we've been able to hear from today. I would love to have just another really great round of applause for everyone that we've heard from. And you know, I'm not sure how I ended up in this probably not enviable position of closing up the day after all of the awesome stuff that we heard after the first panel that everybody was so amazed with and moved by. I was sitting at the table with Alice and Harriet and they're like, oh my God, like how are we gonna top that as the next panel? And I'm like, what am I gonna do when I come up here? There's so much that's already been said and shared, and I have to tell you, just the degree vulnerability, the sharing, the authenticity, and the insights, like the self-awareness, it just blows me away. There were so many moments where I was moved to tears and almost had them trickle, but I'm sitting beside my CEO, Zahid, and I thought, okay, I need to keep myself composed at least just a little bit. But just an absolutely amazing day. I wish that, you know, 30 years ago, a little more than 30 years ago when I started my career, that I would have had the privilege of listening to the woman that we heard today, and how much easier maybe the path would have been just to have heard those insights and understood that others shared the same challenges and that we're all in it together. So I've got notes that I'm going to try and stick to a little bit, but again, it's just been such an impactful day. There's just, I think, so much more that could be said. And when I think about the role that we as women need to play in the future of work and the post-pandemic economic recovery, I really am energized and inspired by the remarkable women that generously shared those insights and experiences today. And for those that weren't able to join us either in person or virtually, just a reminder that people can watch today's event. So please share with anybody else that you think would benefit from hearing the things that we heard today. And when people ask me about what I'm most proud about in my career, I tell them that I'm proud that I've not only survived, but also thrived as a female leader. In male-dominated industries, the majority of my career was in automotive, working with some heavy unionized environments. And my own journey at times, like what we heard from a lot of women today, was marked by circumstances and inequities that many of my male counterparts never had to experience. And when I think about the microaggressions, whether they were intentional or not, that sometimes caused me to feel like I couldn't show up as my authentic self and that I couldn't be seen as strong and different in my own way. And I loved that quote that Harriet shared with us. It's just a waste of a woman to try and be a man. But I'll tell you, it's a challenge when you are in a male-dominated environment. To be seen and respected as a woman, a wife, a stepmom, a daughter of immigrant parents, and a leader all at the same time, it can be very challenging. And when I look back on those experiences, I'm so grateful that today I'm in an organization like Green Shield, where we really do want women to be seen as equals and treated as equals. Because clearly, based on all of the conversation that we had today, the expectations of women in the workplace still have a distance to go. The access to resources for women is different. And the burden of economic and international change is heavier for women. But events like today and programs like Room for Her are drivers of positive impact. Providing women with equitable access to the mental health resources increases their chances of thriving both professionally and personally. And when women have the tools that they need to thrive, it does create a world where more women can become leaders. And that's really how we're going to solve for those inequities, as we heard so many times today. And as a woman in leadership myself, helping other women succeed is something that's always been near and dear to my heart. Again, a common theme that we've heard today. And I'm truly proud of having the opportunity and the role that I play at Green Shield to be able to support the women around me through mentorship, through allyship, and maybe most importantly through the programs and the supports that we're able to build through our focus in social impact. Because we know that it's going to take women lifting up other women to build the momentum that we really need to see the change that we want. In fact, 82% of professional working women believe that visible female leaders will help them advance in their career. And yet, according to the Canadian Women's Foundation, women hold only 25% of all vice president positions and only 15% of CEO positions across the country. So to me, as I'm sure to all of you in this room and those joining virtually, those numbers are unacceptable. Green Shield is committed to addressing and finding solutions to the barriers that working women face. And on top of our work of addressing gaps in the healthcare system for underserved Canadians, Green Shield has also turned its sights inwards. We continue our intentional efforts to improve our hiring and development practices, focused on increasing gender and other diversity representation across GSC. One of the important things that I think kept coming up today as well is the notion of inclusivity. And we recognize it's not just about getting the representation. We continue to work really hard on the inclusivity as well. Over just the last 12 months, 11 employees who identify as female have been promoted to leadership positions in our organization, accounting for 50% of all leadership promotions. And we've hired 15 employees who identify as female into leadership positions, accounting for 55% of leadership hires. And so this progress supports our long-term goal of having 50% gender diversity and 30% other forms of diversity at the leadership level. But more can and must be done. The pandemic opened minds and brought with it the opportunity for a clean slate, the chance to reconsider the way things have been done and to reimagine how we really want them to be done in the future. So I'm proud to work for an organization that's committed to finding a better way for Canadian women, that's committed to encouraging women, to supporting women, and to giving women opportunities to live their healthiest lives, allowing them to thrive both personally and professionally, and take on the leadership positions that they are so well equipped for, as we've seen demonstrated today. And the women in this room are proof positive that when the playing field is leveled, there truly is no stopping us. So thank you again to all the amazing women and all the supportive allies that are in the room with us today and attending virtually, and most importantly, for really being part of this very important conversation. Thank you.